good.
Mr. Hadley.
Coca-Cola is a company whose horizons are endless and whose aspirations to sell fizzy drink limitless. You can get a Coca-Cola just about anywhere. They even tested a vending machine that works at zero gravity, perhaps forgetting that save the odd space station, there's no one there. But back on Earth, Coca-Cola is battling a consumer backlash against allegations the company is ethically out of order. Over the past 2 years, it has lost 4% of its brand value, which is the equivalent of $2 billion, which is the same amount of money the company's going to spend this year telling its consumers that its product just tastes better.
Mr. Hadley? Would you like a Coke?
Never had one. What else haven't I done?
In this advertisement called First Taste, a man at the end of his life fulfills his lost youth after tasting Coca-Cola.
I'm your real dad! Twins.
In reality, any awakening the man does experience is probably more to do with the high levels of the most consumed psychoactive drug in the world, caffeine. The next stop on the Coca-Cola challenge is Australia, where sensory scientist Dr. Russell Keast called for a total ban on marketing caffeinated colas to anyone under the age of 12.
Soft drink manufacturers shouldn't have anything to do with children. If we're talking about schools, any sponsorship of schools, any sales in canteens, any sponsorship of sports events, they shouldn't want to have anything to do with children. Again, comes back to a public health issue, and it's a very serious public health issue.
Dr. Keast is concerned not only with obesity linked to consumption of soft drinks by children, but by the high levels of caffeine contained in an average can of cola, including Coca-Cola.
It's okay for you and me to have caffeine. I've got nothing against caffeine or drinking coffee or drink cola. I think it's a problem when we're talking about children. The addition of caffeine to it may promote consumption. That's an added negative over and above the negative of soft drinks in general.
Every 330 milliliter can of Coke has 34.5 milligrams of caffeine. Diet Coca-Cola's even more. Dr. Keast says that's enough to stimulate cravings and alter behaviour in an adult, but give too much caffeinated cola to children and they can get a little hyperactive. Coca-Cola claims that caffeine is an integral part of its complex flavour. But Dr. Keast says he's done an experiment that shows we can't distinguish between caffeinated and non-caffeinated fizzy drinks.
Potentially the reason for it being in there is modification of consumer behaviour. Let's say if we took a 500ml cola beverage, that would contain enough caffeine to start to put you into a dependent state that caffeine can get you into.
Coca-Cola once said that capturing a high school consumer meant keeping them for 50 to 60 years. That's why endorsements from the likes of Girls Aloud and Wayne Rooney and Friends stars Courtney Cox are so important.
David, I'm in the kitchen. Can I get you anything?
What do you have?
A Coke.
This is a company that's been fined across the world for anti-competitive practices, paying a whopping $20 million after rigging drinks trials in Burger King. They even had a campaign called H2No, and more recently, Cap the Tap, where Coca-Cola guides restaurants on how to suggestively sell fizzy pop over water. The company uses its $2 billion a year advertising budgets so you can't escape its logo. From outer space to the London Underground, it's everywhere. It was even painted on the Himalayas, for which they were fined for environmental damage. So I'm on my way to Baylor College of Medicine in Houston, Texas, to have my head tested. This is where scientists have been studying consumers' emotional response to brands. First off, I'm doing the Coca-Cola Pepsi Challenge.
So here are 30 cups.
Okay.
And 15 pairs. So in each pair,
yeah.
One cup is filled with Coke,
mm-hmm.
the other with Pepsi, but you have no idea which is for which.
Okay.
In this world, there are Pepsi people and Coca-Cola people.
One.
And on taste, I'm a Coca-Cola person.
Five. Eight. This feels weird. I don't think I've drunk this much cola.
This test, though, is to tell whether I can truly taste the difference between the two brands.
I've just done the equivalent of a taste challenge, haven't I? Pepsi taste challenge.
You've just done the Pepsi challenge.
And how did I come out?
You came out square in the middle, came out just like everybody else. You had cups lined up in front of you. There was Coca-Cola in one and Pepsi-Cola in the other. You weren't told which was which. You tasted both and voted with your behavior. I like the one on the right, I like the one on the left, etc. And although, as I know, because we've had a conversation earlier, that you like Coca-Cola and would trade your money for it in a store, you came out absolutely neutral. You couldn't, your nervous system couldn't tell the difference between the two.
It turns out I can't taste the difference between Pepsi and Coca-Cola, just like the scores of others Dr. Montague has tested over the last 3 years, yet I say I prefer Coke. To discover why I think I prefer Coca-Cola over Pepsi, Dr. Montague takes the experiment one step further and puts me inside a magnetic resonance scanner. Tubes feed Coke and Pepsi into my mouth while they flash Coke and Pepsi advertisements at me.
Feel. It's just gonna be a little bit, and whatever comes in your mouth, you're just gonna swallow, okay?
I may be drinking Coca-Cola, but watching a Pepsi ad, or the other way around, I don't know. But the scanner monitors which ads my brain responds to, and guess what? My brain lights up to the Coca-Cola advertisements, even though I may have been drinking Pepsi as I watched them.
Never been the case that you were just drinking a fluid that had flavor. The flavor and the perception of it is a composite perception. It's built out of a lot of pieces of things, including the